Good evening, everyone, once again. Our introduction to the commentary on the Mishnah is what we call Hakdama leperish HaMishnayis. That's how it's commonly known. So this is simply the translation of how that introduction to his Perish HaMishnah is known. The Perish HaMishnah was written well before the Mishnah Torah, well before the halachic work, the Yara Chazaka. But already in his introduction to the Mishnah and his Perish, he clearly states what his larger goals are all about. And the Rambam says, even in his Hakdama to the Perish of Mishnah, HaTo'eles HaShenis, Heim HaPsokim, the second purpose of my writing, briefly, but yet, in a sense, fully, all of the Mishnayos, I'm going to explain, and there were more parts that he did and ultimately wrote, but that are not published, some that were lost. He says, my point is, psokim, I'm doing it so that we can arrive at the final opinion, the halachic bottom line. Sha'emer lecha beferish kol halacha, al das mi nifsaka ha-halacha, so that we will be able to know how does this Mishnah translate into Jewish life, practically speaking. And then here, again from the introduction, the Perish HaMishnayis Hakdama, kasher yizbara li'ishahu mimine ha'adam hadas v'hama'ase. Fascinating way for the Rambam to say what kind of people he hopes to help develop. Look at that language. When a person realizes, when it is clear to him that he is of those who are of both good thought and deed, he's trying to develop people who are of da'as and ma'aseh, people who have a certain intellectual quality, people who live a life with direction, with thought, which of course means you first have to study and then turn it into ma'aseh. Then turn it into action, into deed. Ritzoni lemer b'das letzayir b'sichlo amitas hadvarim al pimasha heim olav. That a person is thinking about the realities of life and what it is that he must do and what he must accomplish. U'lahasik kol ma she'efshel la'odim lahasik. V'hamaaseh, to live, practically speaking, a purposeful life, hu tikun v'yosher hadvarim hativiim. That means that I'm going to find the correct and upstanding path. And he calls them Dvarim HaTivim, with all of nature around me, with all of the natural created world being used in a constructive way, the way God Almighty intended. Notice the universalistic leaning of the Rambam, that it is not just only about how you lead specifically Jewish life, how you lead life, and how all of the world is intended to be guided to a particular set of goals as the Almighty understands. And then here, he says, V'al kein ha'ish, again, this is in the same hakdama of the Rambam to his Perish HaMishnayis, V'al kein ha'ish yehiyah al inyan zeh hu hatachlis v'hu hachefetz. That kind of a person is the ultimate man, that's the desirable man, that's the kind of human being HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. V'zeh hadavar lo noda me'es ha'nevi'im bilvad. This is not just a matter of something that prophets have told us. This isn't prophecy. This is not just exclusively Jewish. He says, "Avol chachmei ha'umos hacholfim, v'asher l'ro'u ha'nevi'im v'lo shamu chachmasam, kvar yodu gam heim, she'ein ha'odam sholem elik she'yekolel hadas v'hama'aseh." A whole human being is a human being with thought, and then that thought directs a purposeful life. So you see that the Rambam is talking consistently about das maisa. We have to have knowledge, and we have to plan then how to implement that knowledge and turn it into maisa. That is what he is already thinking about as he writes the Perish HaMishnah. Meaning that the Rambam, years before he wrote the Yad HaChazaka, was clearly intent upon getting to the Yad HaChazaka. And so right before he writes the Yad, he composes the Sefer HaMitzvos, as was very common in his era and before, Sefer Mitzvos Gadol, the Mitzvos of Rabbeinu Sajigon, to compose the order of Mitzvot as one surmised the 613 might be, and to explain them. But the Rambam already has in mind to begin with an order of Mitzvos, and then to continue with a much larger and more detailed description of how to fulfill those mitzvahs. And he says as much, again, in the Hakdama to Sefer HaMitzvahs, he's already talking about the Yad HaChazakah. Mipnei shekadam lanu hachibur hamafursam asher karanu oso perish ha-mishnah. V'hoysa kavanoseinu b'chibur ha-hu l'katzer biur ha-halacha min ha-mishnah. We wanted to, in brief, describe halacha as it comes, as it is derived from the Mishnah. We didn't want to tell of everything that's muta, tell of everything that's asr. We can't do that. It wouldn't be just. You wouldn't be doing justice to the Mishnah to turn it into a halachic work. We wanted to describe what the Mishnah is saying and what the ultimate bottom line of each Mishnah might be. But to expand upon that, that's going to mean a whole other work. Reisi gamkein she'achaber chibur yichlol kol dinei ha-Torah u'mishpateha. I'm going to compose yet another work. It will include all of the laws of Torah. All of the laws of Torah. Ad shelo yiyeh davar chaser mimenu. Nothing missing. V'she'eseh bo davar shehu min hagil asal. So I'm going to do it as is my want. La'azov zichron ha-machlokas v'ha-mamorim ha-nidochim. I'm not going to go into detail. We're not going to describe the various opinions. We're going to get to the bottom line. V'shela avibo ki im halacha psuka. I'm going to describe the halacha psuka. And we're going to do it, he says, in a particular order, in a particular style. And there, v'chasher kavanasi b'dayti hatachlus azos, samti machshavti be'ezeh ponim achalik achibur u'sha'arov. There we have his saying, I'm not going to follow the Talmudic order. This is where the Rambam has shown both his genius, his originality, and the great purpose, ultimately, that I said before, he had in mind way before, years earlier, to give the Jewish people guidance in a most practical way, and to do so in an order and in a fashion that would take all of the Talmud, but yet organize it in a completely novel way. Organization with novel structure. So he says, I thought about, should I, shouldn't I, use the Masechtas, use the process of Shas and the orders of the tractates of the Talmud, and I decided not to. He says instead, Nirali, Shehatov Shetihia Chalukaso, Sheyusam Halachas Halachas Mokum Masechtos HaMishnah, instead of that which would be the Halacha brought out of a Mishnah, and then the next halacha brought out of the next Mishnah, I will follow what the Torah did in Torah Shebal Peh, what Chazal did, what Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi did in Torah Shebal Peh. There will be a overall book called, let's say, Maseches Beitz, first perek, second perek, third perek, and within each perek, there will be individual halachos, Mako Mishnah, where in the order of Shas, you have Masechtas, Prokim, and then Mishnayos within each perek. I will similarly have a structure of that nature, but I'm not going to follow the order of the Masechtas. I'm not going to follow the order of Shas. Ad sheyomer bo hilchus sukkah, in its own compendium, in its own chapter. Hilchus lulav, in its own chapter. Whereas in Masechtas sukkah, we know you have a discussion that varies from this to that, from one halacha to the other, from one area to the next. I will separate them. Hilchus Tefillin, Hilchus Tzitzis, Hilchus Mezuzah, v'sha'achalik haklal leprokim v'halachos kemo she'ta'aseh ha-mishnah. Atjiyyeh derech mashal. V'hilchus Tefillin, there will be Perek Rishon, Perek Sheni, Perek Shlishi, and then, of course, subdivisions, individual halachos within Perek Rishon. Another set of halachos within Perek Sheni. Another set of halachos within Perek Shlishi. This was a completely novel idea. We take it for granted. And then, of course, after that, the tour, the Balaturnim, similarly created a structure with chapters and then subdivisions in those chapters, but the first to do that in any form or fashion was the Rambam, where until then it was, let's do the mitzvahs. We'll do mitzvah 1, mitzvah 2, number 3, 1 through 613. Or, as we discussed 2 weeks ago, the Rif said, let's look at the Gemara and let's do extraction of halacha and summarization of the Gemara to the point where we understand what the halacha is at the end of the Gemara. But for someone to take that all together and say, okay, now we're going to organize it, all of it, and he says point blank, I'm going to include the halachas that are for our times, that are while we Ba'avonotenu HaRabim do not have a Bet HaMikdash, and we're going to include all of the halachos in Kachim and Taharos that will be, God willing, put into effect when Meheru Yibonu HaMikdash, even though today it's not going to be of any practical consequence. So he says we're going to organize it in this way, and he says I'm going to be very brief. Now, on this issue of his brevity, it's not only brief, but it's fluid. And it's in the language of the Mishnah. So it comes across as being so, something so natural, and it's very clear as one learns the Rambam that it is the Talmud from which the Rambam flows, but it flows. And that's the genius of the Rambam. The fact that he did not cite his sources, as was mentioned by Dr. Abramson, that was very controversial. In two distinct letters, one in which he absolutely defends his position, he says that that was done because the simple point of this all is to live a certain life and to do it naturally and with ease and comfort. Not so much to question and doubt and query as much as to live and to implement Jewish life according to these guidelines. There was a second point, a letter in which he did concede after much of the criticism landed at his doorstep. He said, well, I could have included what the sources were. But that's really something that God wanted. It was the Almighty who said, let it be the Rambam as we know the Rambam. Because, as we're going to see, and as we look at the picture of a page of Rambam, we're going to see that what turned out to be this, let us call it, I don't want to say an error on his part, this decision on his part not to have his sources cited, was a fantastic source of study, of toil, of amelus in Torah that goes on and on and on to this very day. Where from did the Rambam cite? What is his source? Why did he choose this source rather than that? And this is the toil of the typical yeshiva student, because the Rambam is so respected for the cogency of his work, that obviously when he has an opinion, we must find what the reason for that opinion was. Finding that reason, looking for that source, delving into the other opinions of the Rishonim and into the original sources of Midrashic literature, the Talmud, that has become so much the expansion of the Rambam's work. There are hundreds of works on the Rambam's Yad HaChazaka. The third page is again a description of the Rambam's intentions when he puts together the Yad and writes these halachos. He says, "Uvazman hazeh takfu tzaros yiseros v'doch kasha es hakol." Unfortunately, there is so much pressure of the times, the difficult times in which we live, as was described, the oppression at the hands of umot ha'olam, of the Almohad, and it was so much because of the disappearing of common knowledge of Torah. And here he doesn't say it, but elsewhere he basically implies that the Gaonic works did not suffice. Therefore, of the Chochmas Chachameinu, Uvinas Nivonenu Nistatra, understanding is lost. We don't have people who are able to teach. I'm going to set the teachings we need down in writing. Mipnei zeh na'arti chotzni ani Moshe b'Rebbe Maimon hasfardi v'nishanti al hatzur baruch hu, relying on HaKadosh baruch hu uvinosi b'chal elu hasfarim, having studied all these books, all of the original sources, v'reisi l'chaber dvarim hamizbarim b'chal elu hachiburin, and taking together all of that which I have studied, I'm going to compose the laws of Isur, Mutar, Tamei, Tohar, Imshar, Dini HaTorah, Kulan Berloshen Brura, in a clear Talmudic Hebrew, V'derach Kitzara, Ach Torah Shebal Peh, Kula, Sdura B'fi HaKol. So that Torah Shebal Peh, in an orderly fashion, will become something that all of us can partake of and all of us can live by. And here, in the next paragraph, he says something that's very important. He says, everybody, young and old, will know what the law is and how to live Jewish life. No one will need any other book. No one will need any other sefer. He says, we will have a book that you will be able to turn to. It will be the complete and somewhat concise Kola Torah Kula. Hence he calls it Mishnah Torah, because that's what Mishnah Torah was. Mishnah Torah was the repetition of, and in a sense also some abbreviation of, the earlier Torah. Hence Chumash Dvarim is known as Mishnah Torah. He calls it the Yad HaChazakah because that's how Moshe Rabbeinu is described at the very end of the Torah. So what I'm trying to say is that Moshe ben Maimon understood who he was. He really understood what a monumental achievement this would be. And he was unashamedly telling us, I will write this composition of halacha that you will be able to live by. Now, can you imagine somebody saying that I'm going to take all of the Torah, Shibach Sav, Shibach Peh, and lay it out before you in an organized fashion that you will be able to live by? Anybody else would have said something like that? We would say, that's a bit presumptuous. The Rambam knew who he was. See, a great person without haughtiness can say, this is what I'm capable of doing, and this is what these times need. And that was the kind of person the Rambam was. So Moshe Rabbeinu is the one who had the Yad HaChazaka, that great strong hand with which he led the Jewish people and provided us with the Torah. Moshe ben Maimon says of himself, I have that Yad HaChazaka as well. And I'm providing the Torah the way Moshe Rabbeinu provided the Torah. That's the hint in his language. And here we have, just briefly, a description of the 14 sections of the Sefer Mishneh Torah, subtitle Yad HaChazaka. In the first, Echlol Bo HaMitzvos Shehen Ikar Das Moshe Rabbeinu, the essentially religious foundations of Am Yisrael's existence, belief in God, fear of God, love of God, the prohibitions that there not be any other deity, that there not be Avodah Zarah. Karas Yishem Sefer Zet, Sefer Hamada, the book of knowledge. The second book, mitzvot that are of a constant nature, loving HaKadosh Baruch Hu, saying Kriyat Shema, prayer, tefillin, reciting brachos, mitzvahs mila. The third, he writes here about Zmanim Yiduim, particular times of the year, Shabbos, Moadim, concluding with Chanukah and Purim. The fourth book, about marriage, Kedushin, Gerushin, Yibum, Chalitza. The fifth book, about matters of Iser, prohibited relationships, prohibited foods. The sixth book, Mitzvot Shishchayv Odom Behen Misha Asar Atzma Bedvarim, Kegon Shvuos, Unedarim. Those halachos of Shvuos Bitui, when someone takes upon himself an oath, and somebody says a neder. So these are very distinct areas, and all of the halachos that might be brought about any of these areas, anywhere in Shas, drawn from various mesechtos, he compiles them and puts them all together, and in one space, and in one spot, and in a group of sequential chapters. Let's see what those chapters look like, and what the page of the Rambam looks like. This is the very first page of a very traditional copy of Rambam, and there are, of late, really of late, just the past 30, 40 years, new editions of Rambam. Rabbi Yosef Kapich, a great scholar and an important scholar, has taken some of the Rambam's manuscripts, some of the Yemenite manuscripts. The Rambam took his own manuscripts and made corrections in life. He incorporated them all. This is the more and most traditional text, but it's not really as correct as some of the later editions. Then there was the Frankel edition, fantastic number of editions of Rambam. This is the very traditional Shar Blat, if you will, opening page of the Rambam Sefer Hamada, Sefer Rishon of the 14 books. It has, he says, the following mitzvos. Aleph, Leida Sheyesh Shem Eloka, the concept of there being a God. Shelo Yal B'machshav Sheyesh Shem Eloha Acher, that there is no other God. Le'achado, and so on. La'ahavo, to love him. As he described earlier, that's what the first book is all about. And here, you have the very beginnings of some of the most important theological foundations of Judaism. It is argued by some that Mada was not really intended to be halacha. That is not true. The Rambam intends it to be halacha, every aspect of Mada. Because the Rambam says that if a human being is of a certain nature, as we saw before, that human being has a certain das, and then he has to turn das into maisa, into action. So others argue that no, Rambam clearly meant that every part of Yad HaZaka, including Mada, is a halachic work. Halacha does not exist independent of thought, philosophy, purpose in life. It's all unitary. It's all one. So he begins with the ideas of the theological basis of the Judaism. Now, just looking at a page of Rambam, here you have the Kesef Mishnah, which of course was not the first comment. The first commentary on Rambam was the rival, the Ravid, who's a contemporary, Avram ben David of Peskier. He was, of course, one who wrote with respect, but great vehemence about those points where he differed from the Rambam, and his Hasagos are published along with the Rambam. Here we have another page. We'll talk about Hilchas Tshuva in a moment, but let's understand that the Kesef Mishnah predominates throughout the Yad. The Kesef Mishnah was written by Rabbi Yosef Kairo. And Rabbi Yosef Kairo no doubt took inspiration from the Rambam and said, now that the Tur, Yaakov ben Osher, has reorganized halacha into the Shulchan Aruch, I'm going to take what I've learned from Rambam and incorporate it into a Shulchan Aruch based on the structure of the Tur, but with a great emphasis placed on what the Rambam's decisions were. The Kesef Mishnah wrote extensively on the Rambam, in defense of the Rambam, in explaining the Rambam, and that turned on later to become the basis of his halachos, where he says, if the Rambam paskins a certain way, the leaning of the Beis Yosef will be in that direction. Now, as far as having a whole segment of halacha called Hilchas Tshuva, that was a monumental accomplishment. It caused the idea of repentance to be taken seriously. Perek after perek, chapter after chapter, about how to return unto God. He admits at the very onset that it's one mitzvah. He describes it as mitzvah asei achas. Person should, you know, to return to God and admit and confess his sin or her sin. But then to write chapter after chapter of the how of returning to God. It was of such impact because people began to understand that there is a time and a place and a process of improvement and of self-betterment, but it requires reading the Rambam and studying the Rambam, as many do it, particularly Elul, Seris Meit Shuvah. But that was a very innovative move, and very important, and very consequential, to write the Hilchas Tshuva. Now, here we have, again, a page of Rambam. This is in the beginning of Hilchas Tefillah. We have some of the leading scholars who've commented the Migdal Oz, who actually wrote in defense of the Rambam. Many of the Hasagos arrive at this page, does not have any of the Ravid on it. Migdal Oz was Shem Tov ben Avraham of the 13th century. He wrote in defense of the Rambam, as we mentioned before, the Kesef Mishnah. And before the Kesef Mishnah, the Lechem Mishnah, excuse me, Lechem Mishnah came, was after the, Lechem Mishnah was born about 15, 16 years before the Beis Yosef passed away. He was born in 1560 and wrote in Salonika with tremendous insight and what we call lumdus into explaining the Rambam. So these are the basic commentators on the Rambam on the page. Of course, there is also the Magid Mishnah, Vidal of Toulouse of the 14th century. Let's look at the structure of the Rambam here. And we'll use Hilchas Tefillah to appreciate what the Rambam did. Tefillah is a mitzvah, He here says that in Hilchas Tefillah we will have this mitzvah to pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and the bracha that the Kohanim have to give is yet another mitzvah. Now, we could just say, well, there's a mitzvah to daven. But that's a bit oversimplified. The Rambam took all of the issues surrounding tefillah and divided them into appropriate chapters. Within each chapter, he proceeds from A to B to C to D. Let's take a look at what the Rambam did and how he did that. He says, mitzvah saseh lehispalel b'chol yom. It's a mitzvah to daven every day. Shenemar, he quotes from the Pasuk, avadatem es Hashem alekechem. Mipi hashmua lamdu, meaning there's a tradition to understand that those words mean, tefillah shenemar lo'avdu b'chol avavchem, what is avodah shebelev? What is the heartfelt means of serving? How does one serve God with one's heart? That is through tefillah, through prayer. So he introduces it with thought and with a feeling for what it is that tefillah is. It's not just the cold do's and don'ts, but it's the how-tos that are the crux of what he's going to get to. Halacha beis. So who has to daven? Lefichach, doshim, avodim. The fact that the Rambam said that Nashim, women are to daven just like men, very consequential. To this day, it has been so decided halachically by the vast majority of Achronim as well. Here, in Halacha Dalet, he explains how and why it came about that we have a Sidur, that we don't just pray any which way as I want, as you need to, everyone should pray his or her own way. No, he explains how it came about that people could not express themselves in Lashon HaKodesh. It did not any longer flow or roll off our tongues and out of our mouths, the way it used to when the Beis HaMikdash perhaps stood. Certainly during Bayis Rishon, people would be able to converse with each other and express themselves to the Almighty in Hebrew, more so than after the Golus. And therefore we have a standardized Siddur. So he explains this early on. Let's look at the beginning of the second chapter. So after he has described how Chachamenu gave us the Shemona Esrei, the original 18, he then begins Perek Sheni with a description of the 19th bracha, and explains how it came about that there's a bracha v'lamal shinim, and he describes how Rabbi Gamliel's times were challenging because of the minim, those we would call politely sectarians, who were mostly Jews originally, but then Christians, who were oppressing us. And then he goes on to describe how every day, b'chol tefillah, shebechol yom, mispal adam tsha esrei brachos elu al haseder. And he then goes on to say that there are times when you would have the abbreviated bracha, known as havi neinu. That's in halacha gimel. So there's a rhyme and reason to how these halachos are ordered. Finally, in the third perek, getting a little more specific, he begins to describe tefillas shachris. Tefillas HaShachar, mitzvah sashiyascha l'spalel, what are the times when you begin davening? What is the earliest you can daven? Im hanetz hachama, preferably when the sun rises. Uzmana, until ad sof sha'a rivi'is, shehi shlishis hayom, till the end of the fourth hour, which is the third of the day, dividing the day, of course, into what we call sha'a uzmanios. Note, he left out the opinion, and we should not take it as one that we will ever use, the opinion of the Chachamim, who say that you can daven Shacharis until noon, until Chatzos. That's a dangerous thing to tell somebody, because, oh, what do you mean? I don't have to daven early in the morning. I have until noon. No, you don't, because as the Rambam and before him others and after him everyone says, no, you have to daven by Sof Zman Tefillah. But he doesn't get to that in the first parak. He gets to it appropriately in parak shlishi. So here he starts to talk about first shacharis, then mincha, and then he'll talk about tefillas arvis. The magnificence of the Rambam's organization and the fluidity with which he presents, without anything being difficult or without it being, so to speak, I don't want to use the word, but I have to. There's no other word that says it. Without a kvetch. Meaning that it flows, and it flows naturally. That is, that this is how we live, and it's not difficult. And it's something that is correct, and naturally so. All of this is so unique, and so original, and of course so impactful, because after the Rambam's work, everybody understood, now we have codified the Torah, Shebichsav, Shebal Peh, and then taking up, or picking up where the Rambam left off, you have the later codifiers, mostly the Shulchan Aruch, Beis Yosef, about whom we'll learn in a few weeks' time, who took that idea of codification to the next level. This is the monumental work of the Rambam. It's the central work of the Rambam. As we have seen, it was with this work in mind that the Rambam began to write the Perish HaMishnah, the Sefer HaMitzvos. And it's with this centrality in mind with which he wrote the Mora HaNevuchim as well. Because he basically said, Das, knowledge and understanding, and mindfulness, and a direction in life, an understanding of the entire world and our place in that world, has at its center what we live, how we live, with some explanation as to why we live as we do. And so this magnum opus, the Yad HaChazaka, remains today the single most important work, perhaps, of any of the Rishonim of the era. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you.